earlier today, I guess it was yesterday now, it's early in the morning on Wednesday, God had me post, as I call it, flip a previous post on the dismissal of the rabbis that you find in Ezekiel. It's the only time there's any real mention of the descendant of King David in Isaiah chapter 11. And it says, when he's there, because this is how it reads, basically God says, I'm going to have a reckoning and dismiss the shepherds of the flock. Okay, that's the rabbis, the flock of the Jewish people. God kind of left me hanging on that one. I don't know if the flock is only those who are observant, or if it's all Jews in general. I think it's all Jews in general of the flock, but he's primarily concerned with those who are religious and practice Judaism in one manner or another. Okay, that was terrible. Earlier today, I posted on YouTube a video regarding the dismissal of the rabbis, the reckoning and dismissal of God, which you never hear them talk about in this utopia that comes when King David's descendant is here. God's servant David, a shepherd. That's what he calls him in Ezekiel. And I had mentioned that I needed to get my books published for the covenants of God to go into effect, that come with me, because I am David, and for that matter, I'm Elijah the messenger. So as Elijah, I can speak with the angel of God's presence, who is the angel of the covenant that you desire, and make that official. That the new comes into effect because it includes sin forgiveness, just as the Assyrian Babylonian exiles were forgiven, because there's another temple to be built. And as I've said, that's not like Christianity. That doesn't mean everybody goes to heaven. You have to be written into the scroll of remembrance as those who revere and esteem his name. And this is coming from Malachi 3. Now, the dismissal is from the eyes of God. It's not dismissal from being rabbis. It's not dismissal from being the synagogues. It's they join those who do not heed and revere his name. Now, I know that's kind of hard to believe. Every single rabbi, yes. And we know it's when Moshiach comes, because God says, I'm going to dismiss them. And I'm going to appoint my shepherd David, my servant David, to be a shepherd amongst them. And be a leader amongst them. Okay, that would be me. And it has nothing to do with being a king, establishing the Davidic dynasty, or being a ruler over them. It says ruler among them. And basically what is being said is, it's my teachings that are in these, that God gave me in these books that he dictated and I typed. It's a long process. It wasn't straight dictation by any means, but that's the effect of it. They're not my words, they're his. And that will be my position as the leader amongst them. This is what God wants known for the day of the Lord, and not this messianic era that you've heard about throughout your lives, where people will live to be 1,000 years, the entirety of the world will speak Hebrew, the world will be perfected, all of Israel will follow Torah, Moshiach will study Torah day in and day out, and quite frankly, I really look at it. God says they have done everything you can do with the Torah. Really, I just deal with the prophecies, the prophets, the day of the Lord, and these false teachings. primarily, they come from Tovia Singer of Outreach Judaism and Jews for Judaism. And the only person I ever really see is Michael Skoback. I know that there are others in that organization. And because of them, you say, well, wait a minute, you just got a handful of rabbis? Said, most of us don't even think about this thing, this Messianic era. But every rabbi's dismissed. And I'll put it to you like this. This is the God of Israel. This is not Jesus Christ. Okay? He is not a human being. It doesn't bother him one bit to punish all for the wrongs of a few. It's that simple. I mean, he took credit for a plague that had killed 70,000 Israelites because to put David to a test. Which, by the way, he failed, and because of that failure, he finally got it right. That's when he went and bought the Temple Mount. It was a thresher place, a wheat thresher or something. I'm not sure. It's kind of a restitution to God. But, you know, see, that doesn't bother him. Absolutely nothing bothers him, actually. But he's not human. You know, he's an entity. You know, he says, let's form man in our image. And he's talking to his Holy Spirit, the angel of his presence. And the image, you know, it doesn't mean we're human beings because he's human being. The image is we are beings in existence, living beings with emotions. He does have emotions. But, you know, it stops right there. That's the image, and that's the only image. He's not human being. Doesn't care for the Christians one bit, saying that the God of this planet, the God of creation, is a human being, or become a human being. The idea would appall him. But yes, he will. He will. And, you know, part of that is he says, well, if the other rabbis don't like it, they better get on them about it. And tell them, well, wait a minute. Just tell them what they're doing wrong. And if that doesn't work, go to their flocks. Go to their people. Go on top of them. You got numbers. Same thing the Christians over the Jews. They got numbers. We're going to break those numbers down. We're going to make it so that the few have a heavier slingshot with me here and with what he can do with me and the things that he has taught me. And, what you know, completely miss the point. Isaiah 53 is a snare. It's for this day. So many things are. Jesus is a Jew. I'm a Gentile. Now, you've never heard anybody say, Moshiach is a Gentile and comes from a Christian country. But yet there it is, Isaiah 63. Who is this coming from? Adam? It is I, God. Well, who's he come with? The prophet like Moses. And who am I? The righteous servant, the descendant of David, described in Isaiah 53 as the sages believe and is put into the Talmud as the leper scholar. Well, I am a scholar. I went to Texas A&M University, then I went to law school. And I've had three cancers, two that just about killed me. They're just going to have to stop all that. And God wants those books he dictated to me to become a part of Judaism for an understanding of what a man of divine beings is, for an understanding that the prophets were all men in divine beings, that Moses was a man in divine beings. These things weren't known. They've been put before you. We've had over 2,000 people typing in the name, searching. They must be typing in Moshiach, Isaiah 53, or words of that effect for me to be getting the views that I'm getting. So it's people who, you know, if no rabbi has looked at it, I would be amazed. But what really needs to be done here is those that are listening, you need to go to your rabbis and tell them, look, God's got it. We believe God's here. In other words, be the witnesses. will the witnesses do? Well, you got to be a servant to God. He needs you to recognize his prophet and tell as many people as you can who can believe our report, who can believe what we now believe. Who has the arm of the Lord been revealed on? Well, it's me. Now, I just, it's uploading right now, I'm getting ready to put verse 1 of Isaiah 53 covering just that topic. And it's got a lot of good information. I'm going to follow it up with verse 2 and 3 and 4. They've been done before. But they'll have a little different title. So I think they were called Leper Scholar versus Jesus, round 1 and round 2, et cetera, et cetera. There's about 7 of them. I'll get to that throughout the day. But as I had mentioned, the book's being published. We put, you know, all Jews on notice that, okay, you have a clean slate. She needs to come back to synagogue. And as I was also saying, this snare. See, it's full of these words like he was wounded for our sins, that the Christians just jump all over. But he doesn't die. There's no crucifixion in it. And it turns out all these words had to do with me going through his fire refinement. In his power, he has crushed me, bruised me, maltreated me to no end. And he hadn't been maltreated until God does it to you. He's good. He's real good. And as I said, is one of my first lessons was, Keith, your pain doesn't mean anything to me. I have a place I'm taking you, and this is how I do it. And, of course, we've had endless fights about it and arguments. But after 13 years, and it hadn't slowed down, every year has been more intense. And that includes the days that I'm doing this right now. Boy, and I've been complaining. I wrote your books. I've been doing videos. And he says, hey, this just makes it better. I can get you excited again because you've been maltreating it so much worse. But there's been great change in me, and a really huge part of it is it's not just changing me. It's because he can use his power on my emotions. He can make standing in front of people and saying, I'm Moshiach. And, you know, that's not something normally I could do without just being embarrassed, or I see the look of people's faces of disbelief and that kind of feeling that you get from that. See, I don't have to feel that. He prevents it. It's part of the process, you know. In a way, I'm being changed in a brutal fashion. But at the same time, in the years to come, and look at me, I'm supposed to be dead 20 years ago. And I'm probably looking at another 20 or 30 of one fun time, doing things I could never do of my own. I just wasn't a very social person, let's put it that way. But that's going to be coming out. But basically, instead of waiting for the books, God has decided this is as good as publishing those books. And the rabbis are on notice. He says, I want you to tell them. A reckoning is a judgment. And God's judgment is you're dismissed. You will never see the scroll of remembrance. And you're sin free. And you practice Judaism to a T, specifically those who are Orthodox. And that's, you know, that's not even taking into account the amendment. The amendment is being mindful of the laws I gave Moses at Horeb. It's in Malachi 3, right before you see Elijah, when it says he recounsels family members one to the other. Well, that's how he does it. What does Elijah get? One, he gets sin-free people. He's basically just telling them to come back. Two, God is here. Look at what all's happened. Look what the people are saying. Listen to the report of the witnesses. Three, against the Christians, the man of Isaiah 53 is a Gentile, he's not a Jew. Can't be Jesus. Oh, and also Isaiah 11, this man comes from the stump of Jesse, not the felled ancestral tree. That's where Jesus comes from. His line is the line of kings that we read in Kings 1 and Kings 2 that he banished. He banished when these Babylonians destroyed Jerusalem and the temple. He banished them. That's it. Nobody of your line will ever rule again. So Jesus couldn't have ever been a king of the Jews. Well, he wasn't any King David, that's for sure. And anyway, so much to do, so much to get done. But this is what, you know, God is just putting them in a headlock saying, y'all going to listen to me this time, you learned men. You're going to listen to my prophets, my prophets. Although I guess in a sense I'm, but you know, I'm a righteous servant. Isaiah 53 describes a righteous servant. David, King David was a righteous servant. Elijah's a righteous servant. Prophet like Moses, a righteous servant. And that's just, you know, I'm going to handle it all. I mean, can you imagine God doing what he's doing with me with four different men? And they don't have a description. I have a description, which, again, I just put in verse 1. And where you can find the version of my commentary on Isaiah 53 that specifically says it's me. The first book, we just, God wrote it so that it just sounded like I could be saying it's me. But not so the second book, The Life of God's Righteous Servant. That's my life. And there's no holding punches on it. And we do Isaiah 53 in the last chapter again, this time specifically relating the events of my life, as you just read, to each verse. And that's what I'm... We'll be uploading to YouTube today. I'm sure we'll get through all of it. I have had some computer problems. But anyway, that's just a short message because clearly there are a handful of people who are really watching what I say. I mean, within hours of me posting something, you know, there's a quick three. And so, you know, whether they know each other, this or that, I don't know. I'm in the dark on this. See, God won't tell me those kind of things. I don't know what people are thinking. I don't know what Toby Singer has heard or not heard. I can only make my own suppositions. Anything I couldn't know of my own, they don't tell me. And there's all kinds of reasons for that, but some of them are obvious. I'm not going to get into it. Even time frames. I mean, I can only suppose that we're getting closer and closer to something breaking on this in one way or another. And basically that comes down to the witnesses. You know, you can't just read it and think to yourself, oh, I believe him. If you believe, you need to do something proactive. Whatever, anything you can think of. Bring it to the attention of your rabbi. And you're sin-free now. You need to get back to synagogue if you're not at synagogue. If you're just sitting at home on the internet saying, I'm a good Jew. You need to be mindful of his laws. You need to attend the high holidays. You need to show the world that more Jews practice Judaism than Christians practice Christianity. You know, the percentage-wise, Judaism is I believe, still ahead. Okay, that's a whole other thing. That's a whole other topic I hadn't looked at in quite some time. There's some studies that come out every few years regarding Muslims, Christians, and Jews. But I thought Jews kind of led the way percentage-wise, not number-wise. So, is there anything else? Thank you for listening.